Hello, and welcome to Breast Cancer Conversations, a podcast brought to you by SurvivingBreastCancer.org. I am Laura Carfing, breast cancer survivor and founder of SurvivingBreastCancer.org, a nonprofit organization providing community, education, and resources to empower those diagnosed with breast cancer and their caregivers from day one and beyond. Hello, hello, my friends. I am so excited for today's episode because we have a very special guest with us today. His name is David Victor, and he's with the band Boston. He started his own charity called Harmony and Healing. And what I'm so excited about is that on Breast Cancer Conversations today, we get to raise each other up by talking about all of the amazing work that other organizations are doing, the great work that they're bringing to the community, and really just letting you guys know about the amazing resources out there. So I am so excited. Today is also a really fun episode because we bring in my caregiver, partner in crime, co-founder of Surviving Breast Cancer, William LaFerrier. Some of you guys may know William if you attend our Thursday Night Thrivers support group. Every Thursday night at 7 p.m., William is a regular there. You can register for Thursday Night Thrivers or any of our virtual free online programs at survivingbreastcancer.org/events. William came to all of my medical oncology appointments. He never missed an infusion, a radiation session. Granted, I was diagnosed pre-COVID when like bringing people to the hospital like was a thing. But again, I am so excited because William will be leading today's interview. He is a huge music aficionado and the perfect one to connect and speak with David. You are in for a treat because David will serenade us, play a couple songs, some hits, as well as some of his own originals.
Doing music for people who really need, you know, healing and some spiritual sense of hope. I mean, there's no comparison. Music heals wounds that medicine can't touch.
Welcome to the conversation.
Whatever ails you, you know, music can cure you, in my humble opinion.
Oh, you're spot on, spot on. Without further ado, we'll let you introduce yourself and your charitable organization.
Excellent. Well, thank you, William. Thank you, Laura. My name is David Victor. My charity is called Harmony and Healing. And what we do very simply is live music for patients, their families, loved ones, primarily via Zoom or FaceTime or any remote things these days. Although pre-pandemic, we were, you know, going into hospitals and healthcare facilities, Ronald McDonald houses, cancer support groups, and just doing music.
What made you decide to jump into it? I know we read the website, et cetera, so yeah. We know what's out there. But in your own words, first off, a tip of the hat to you. We love this stuff. We think it's just absolutely incredible and applaud your every effort. So whatever we can do to help you guys, we're more than happy to do so. So
very, very appreciated. Yeah. And you guys, I mean, you know, it's a mutual admiration society for, you know, when people are in this space of trying to help people. When I was touring with Boston, I got a chance to be a part of another charity that had, I'm not sure how long they'd been around, but their mission was to go into children's hospitals and do art, food, and music. It was sort of a little party thing, you know, let's get them to draw and let's let them listen to music and feed them and stuff. There's a lot of moving parts with that. I mean, getting food into a hospital, for one thing, right?
Right.
A little bit of a challenge. And like, are these crayons, will they make my child allergic or whatever, you know? Music, nobody really had a problem with, you know, singing back then. Of course, now, you know.
Different story.
Sometimes things have changed. But at that point, to me, it was the easiest thing in the world. And I had an opportunity to do two of these visits. And the first one I did at Miller's Children's Hospital in Long Beach was just so impactful, just personally. I remember, you know, I didn't know what I'd be facing. So I went to Miller Children's Hospital, did this day with the music and the food and everything that was happening, and just came away from it just feeling just this elation at, you know, I don't want to disparage anything about music, but I will say this. People who are, let's say, in a casino and get a complimentary ticket to go see a classic rock band that they have heard of, and maybe they show up and maybe they don't, and, you know, you're playing in front of, you know, maybe 5,000 people and the first two rows are empty, you know, because those are all the high rollers go. And you see, like, these people, they really enjoy it. They're having the time of their lives. You're really bringing back these kinds of memories for them. And, you know, I have more to say on that later. But, you know, they're at the very top of the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right? You just say, you know, they can take it or leave it. Of course, they love it, but it's not maybe going to change their direction of their life. Whereas doing music for people who really need, you know, healing and some spiritual sense of hope. I mean, there's no comparison in my mind. It was just like night and day kind of an experience. And they both, I mean, I think they both have their, you know, mediums and validity, but as a performer, there's so many places you play that you feel like, you know, I'm love to play anytime, but I mean, did I have the impact, you know, that maybe I had. And when you go and do these, you know, hospital visits and you do the Zooms and the FaceTimes, you see the people, you communicate with them. I mean, there's just no comparison. I mean, it's like you're feeding them this spiritual food, and it's hard to even describe what, I mean, you do poetry, right? And you do different art and different mediums. It's a different, I mean, I found a quote actually that was, music heals wounds that medicine can't touch. And I just thought, wow, that's exactly what we do with Harmony and Healing.
Onward we go. That is, that's wonderful. So naturally you get even more out of it than your audience, your new audience that you're playing for, because it's such an incredible labor of love, and you know that you're reaching them
right
in this very ethereal way.
I'm glad you bring that up, because again, like the kinds of places musicians are often asked to play are just, you know, I mean, it's fun, it's a party, but it's just a different vibe. Like, it's a different activity that's going on almost literally. And, you know, they, like I said, they both have their place, but I feel like for a musician to be able to do something so meaningful with their art and so connective and so just impactful is not a thing that you get to do very often. And so with Harmony and Healing also, our musicians are paid for their services, right? It's super meaningful work, essentially. And I feel like, you know, as a fellow musician, that we're serving two populations, right? We're giving our services away for free to the, you know, the patients and families and loved ones. And we're supporting this artistic community with hyper meaningful work, you know, paid hyper meaningful work, so that they can pay their health insurance and auto insurance, things like that too. So
yeah. Wonderful. So from that perspective, what type of music do you play?
I was fortunate enough to do a little bit of booking in the San Francisco Bay Area, and booked it was a shopping center. And so I had to get all these different kinds of musicians, right? And ended up, I got a harpsichord player. I got a fiddle player, which, like, with a fiddle, you can't not smile. The funny thing about Boston was, you know, I put a YouTube video up, and that's how I was, you know, discovered by the band. So it was very democratic. I feel like you didn't have to already, ooh, I know Sammy Hagar, and he hooked me up with Flippity Flap, you know, or Mickey Hart or whatever. So in that sense, you know, it's just like I got onto the map just by the, you know, what I was doing, right? The bands I was playing with. The Bay Area has always been a super musical area. I think it always had this special vibe to it growing up here. You know, and the you know, we were proud of the, you know, the acts that came out of here, the Grateful Dead and Journey, of course, and, you know,
Trent, Jefferson,
Metallica, Jefferson Airplane, Jefferson Starship. So many great bands. In fact, parenthetically, I have a band called Supergroup SF, and we do just the hits of the San Francisco Bay Area music scene. And if you just listen to the show, you wouldn't necessarily know that, right? It's just some of the greatest classic rock ever written. So it's a fruitful creative area.
Right. Beautiful. Yeah, we loved it. We took a trip a couple of years ago, just prior to COVID, And we picked a friend up. He was a Berklee College student via Alberta, Canada. And he graduated, flew out to work in the East West studio in L.A. We're still in Boston. We told him that we're planning on hitting Yosemite and a couple of other parks in the area, and we were wondering if you'd like to join us for a day or two or 2 weeks. And he said, "Count me in for the whole thing." So we changed plans, and instead of renting a Jeep, we grabbed this enormous pickup truck. We threw all the gear and picked him up in L.A. and drove up to Yosemite, and then finished for about a week and a half in San Fran, hitting all the various sites, including.
You are living the life. You're living the dream.
Oh my God! Yeah, what a ball.
We make me look like an old fuddy-duddy, will you?
Well, it speaks volumes to how much we love your city. So,
oh yes, it's lovable. It is lovable. Historically lovable.
It is incredible. So back, and I'm sorry I distracted you, but back to how you select songs to play for your audience.
Yeah.
Basically, sometimes you're playing for babies, and sometimes you're playing for folks in the geriatric ward. So everything in between.
Yeah, no, great question. It hasn't been easy, right? Because you never necessarily know what you're facing when you go in, when you play, like when I played at Stanford Children's Hospital, I try to stick to the poppiest, you know, pop I can grab onto with an acoustic guitar and a voice. Of course, this is just my experience, but, you know, other musicians, depends on what I think might be needed. So when you ask me, you know, what are the other things that we have, I've actually got a steel drummer. I've got like a jazz trio. I've got a lot of different things that can be brought to bear on this, you know, for this services of this charity. So it really just depends. Like if something has gone well one time, you know, the tendency is like, well, we should probably do that again. But song choice wise, so the funny thing about children is, like, when I was at the very first thing I did, I mean, I didn't have anything prepared, right? I mean, it was just completely off the cuff, like, well, hey, play some Boston music. Like, okay, 1976 was the first Boston album, and these children are six, five, you know?
Yeah.
Not sure how familiar they are with the deeper album cuts.
No.
The interesting thing was, and kind of funny to me, is they didn't care, you know, like it was music. It was something being created in front of them. And again, we were in person at that point, but I mean, live is live. Live musical performance is this creation that's happening. I'm not even sure how to describe it, but I mean, I always think of it like the closest thing that humans have ever invented to magic. You know, we look at technology as magical, you know, and I'm in the technology field. I do digital marketing and stuff, and I see all this stuff happening and AI and all this stuff. But I mean, when it comes to just creating something that speaks just directly, just bypasses all your logic and reasoning circuits and goes right to your soul, in the same way, like you can walk down a street and smell jasmine or something, and you just go, it just takes you back. Right. And music definitely has the same effect. For me, when you think about what's going on in somebody's mind, who's listening to a song that was popular when they were 19 and a half, you know, and it was, you know, the summer of 1976. And they're like, you know, they're completely on fire, completely alive. Hormones are raging and everything. And you are taking them back. And when they see that and experience that and hear that, they're right there. I mean, it's like I'm 19 again and everything's all right. Everything's going to be all right. The fact that I was in the band afforded me the opportunity to be part of this charity because, you know, they asked me to do it. I was living in LA at the time and I was, more than happy to do it. They sent a photographer along and I was just like, it was just so much joy, you know, and I kept looking for my opportunity to do it more. Yeah. And I kept talking to them, they're like, well, we got to do this and we got to do that and we got to organize. And like I said, it's hard to get food in. It was just, there were a lot of moving parts. And I just finally, and it took me long enough, but in 2018, I think I filed my papers for my 501c3 and said, you know, I'll just do this. It's not that complicated, right? There's no,
Beautiful.
there's not really a whole lot of paperwork. Although when I was going to the hospitals, you know, they want you to be vaccinated. You got to sign up for volunteer training. I mean, you guys probably deal with this all the time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how do you select your sites? Like what's on your docket? How many performances do you try and do a month or a quarter or a year?
Yeah. I mean, so we have a sign up on our site. The inquiries come in. Then it's a matter of just coordinating it with the right, you know, artist for that. You know, like we have in California, we have a large Hispanic population. We get, you know, maybe something that's maybe more appropriate for that audience if they want it, you know.
Sure.
And just lining up the right artist with the right, you know, situation. And we can do many, many of these. I mean, we're averaging at this point probably 30 a month.
That's amazing.
Wow.
Yeah. Awesome. I mean, so it's going right. And it's just getting the word out really about it now, because I have a large, you know, group of musicians who are, you know, love to do this stuff and, are delighted to do it. But of course it's a very private thing. You know, besides HIPAA and stuff, it's just, you know, you're dealing with people a lot of times end of life, you know, situations and, you know, it's not like, hey, this is great for social media. So it's, you know, getting the word out, you have to, you know, balance, you know, be sensitive to the whole situation, obviously. And that usually just means nothing's going to, you know, nothing's going to be known other than that exchange that you had with that person, their family, their loved ones. We do with Zoom, obviously, and different, you know, mechanisms are able to do recordings, you know, so the people that were involved, you know, usually it's a, you know, a loved one or family member that sets up the situation, sets up the visit, virtual visit. And so they, you know, get a copy of the recording and they can share. And of course, anybody, I mean, this is not news anymore, but when we started doing it, people were still not as used to Zoom, but, you know, anybody around the world can participate and do, you know, that. So there's no travel involved for anyone really.
So I'll stop you there again, David. We have an audience in 81 countries.
Speaking of audience, can we ask David to play a song for us?
So in this particular song, I would like you to address an audience of stage 4 breast cancer survivors, their regarding their bucket list.
Stories and songs of hope. I think we talk a lot about in our community, right? Being diagnosed with something terminal, where on the outside, I think people sometimes think, oh, you have hair or you look fine. But on the inside, realizing that there's this cancerous thing that's, you know, wreaking havoc.
I need a sign to let me know you're here. All of these lines are being crossed over the atmosphere. I need to know things are gonna look up. 'Cause I feel it's drowning in a sea filled from a cup. And there is no place safe and no safe place to put my head. You can see
I'll stuck it. Hang on.
Yeah.
Here we go. One more time.
I need a sign. Let me know you're here. Cause I feel us drowning in a sea filled from a cup. And there is no place safe and no safe place to put my head. And you can feel the world shake from the words that are said. And I if you don't give up. I won't give up if you don't give up. A piece.
All right. If anyone like was not smiling for that last 2 minutes, I mean, this is music and magic happening all at the same time. Thank you.
Oh, my God. Absolutely. So sweet. A beautiful song. Well chosen for a terminally ill patient. No question about it.
You make a really good point, which is what are the songs, right? What are the when you do want to pick songs? And I made a little list of like songs for healing, right? So it's very, very easy to come across a song. Oh, people love this. Oh, I didn't think about those lyrics. Not appropriate. So one time I was playing for I went out to Modesto and did a general hospital, but I went to the pediatric ward, and there's these little infant babies. There's a picture of it on my website.
Yes.
A picture of, and they're in the, you know, their little incubators and stuff, their little hats on. And I'm like, what's the sweetest, calmest song I know? And
let's hear it.
Well, it would have been good, right, if I prepared that, but it was Shannon Donahue, she's drifted out to sea. Remember that song?
Maybe she'll find an island with a shady tree.
You know, it's falsetto all the way through, you know.
That's
okay. So I thought the babies will like this, and they all pulled through. So
that's amazing.
I bet they did.
Yeah,
that's amazing. Music is so healing, and as you were saying, David, it could transport you. It can bring you to a different place in time. And we talk a lot about pain management in our breast cancer community, and how can music really help us move away from the physical. All right, what's up next? What else do you have for us?
Jimmy Allen, Brad Paisley, Freedom Was a Highway. Have you heard that song?
No, but
beautiful. Like the lyrics are just like, it's like, oh my God. I could just visualize him writing each line in a book and different on different pages. And then at one point going, oh no, this works here and this works here and this works. And it's just beautiful. Just the imagery, right? And so you get into it, right? You hear a song that connects with you in a certain way and has this lyrical imagery. So I think sometimes with, you know, people maybe they aren't familiar with maybe a song that you're playing or, you know, because preparation, you're right, is a big part of it, right? They'll go, oh, I had somebody request the other day, I don't know, a particular Foreigner song that I hadn't played for a long time and never played on guitar because I'm usually just singing it.
Right.
And so, you know, learning it and like trying to play it confidently and everything, it takes some preparation sometime, you know. So, but you do it and boy, they really appreciate it. I'll tell you that.
Yeah. What is the song that most moves you?
Wow.
That most transports you?
That's almost too easy, William.
Yeah.
That's too easy. Let's see if I can warble out a few notes here. I hate capos. Do you play guitar, William?
I do. I have three. We call it the Situation Room. I've got a Strat, a Martin, and an Ibanez hollow body, and I've got a big Fender reverb. As a matter of fact, Laura and I played to our group one night. They had been after me forever to, and Laura plays piano. They had been after me forever to sing a song. And I finally agreed, I played Knocking on Heaven's Door.
Nice.
And I just, that's one of those songs that just always did it to me.
Well, see now, so that's a song you like to play for your population. That's a good one for you.
Yeah. Well, it's a little bit weird on the lyrics.
That was one I took off my list, right? You know, like,
yeah, exactly. Well,
yeah.
How about
temporarily bypassing Heaven's Door?
Yeah.
Leaving a note at heaven's door. And
yeah, there you go. Leaving a note on knock, knock on heaven's door. Here you go. Let's leave that note.
Probably my favorite Boston song of all time I was extremely fortunate when I joined the band. I thought I was going to be just kind of a utility infielder and maybe get a couple songs to sing because they had a lead singer. They still have the same lead singer, actually, a fabulous singer. But the band leader liked how I sounded on certain songs, right?
And nice, so yeah.
As it turned out, for the first tour, I got a chance to do my favorite Boston song of all time. And maybe you'll recognize this one, William.
Yeah, baby. I knew you were going to sing this one. Yeah, sweet. Absolutely. Oh my God.
So that was
Did Tom write all those songs or was it a mix of the boys?
It was Tom and Brad, the singer.
Brad, yeah, Delp,
wrote,
yeah.
And I wasn't junior high then, so.
Yeah.
Privy to that, but got boned up on my Boston history obviously when I joined the band.
Sure.
Started to try to learn the many tales of the band. Right. And it's been around, like I said, 1970, well, before 76. I mean, the album came out in 76, the first one.
Right.
Which still sounds great to this day, by the way. If you put that thing on.
Oh, it absolutely does.
Put some nice Bose noise-canceling headphones on.
And just blasting off.
I did a little too much of that, William. My ears ring all the time, man.
Yeah, well, and I tell people that because we're in a condo, I play, typically I play the amp through my headphones. And so I have a smaller amp for that. And then when the neighbor leaves, then I can bring out the Fender. Now, how about, who's your favorite lyricist?
Ooh, good question. I value the ability to speak, but the ability to write lyrics that are just the perfect, simple lyrics, right? Okay. In that song I just mentioned, he says, "We were summer young," I'm like, summer young. Those are perfect words to put together. Young's been used a million times. Summer's been used a million times.
Right.
Summer young rolls off the tongue, you know, like, so I love lyrics that are really comfortable to sing, being a singer.
Sure.
So I have actually 5 albums of original material myself. And when I've written my own stuff, sometimes I'll just yell into what used to be called a tape recorder and just noises that sound good, melodies that sound good over chords. And, then later on, words seep into your brain. That's, you know, coming from the creator, in my opinion, because it's just like I'm just allowing it to come through finally. I sort of made the the animal noises that were the, you know, beginnings of it, but finally figured out the lyrics later. And so long answer again, but lyricist, I mean, I love Don Henley.
Yeah.
You know, like just, ooh, that's talking about the Grateful Dead. I always think of that line in his song. Just that super easy to sing, but just super insightful and just, you know, beautiful. And then I like, you know, Holly Knight was a songwriter that wrote a bunch of songs. I mean, I was listening. We saw the David Geffen documentary the other day. And
yeah.
Laura, you remember Laura Nero?
Yeah, of course.
So Laura Nero wrote, you know, I Love You, Bill. You know, that one.
Yeah, she wrote.
She wrote Eli's Coming.
Yeah, Three Dog Night, baby. Yeah.
Three Dog Night. I mean, she did them all before that. But I mean, what a brilliant lyricist. Weird, unusual, like, themes and stuff. But, man, just incredibly artistic, you know.
Yeah, it's like Randy Newman used to write all those songs that others, or Warren Zevon would be.
Yes.
Composing.
Oh, my God. I can't remember the first line. I saw a werewolf drinking a pina colada at Trader Vic's.
Trader Vic's.
His hair was perfect.
That may be one of the absolute best lines I've ever heard in a song.
It's great. I know. I love a lyric that just sort of drops. You know, I saw a werewolf drinking a pina colada at Trader Vic's. His hair was perfect.
Yeah, it's just like, who says that? It's just absolutely perfect. And,
it is.
And the visualization was spot on.
Yeah, so it just brings smiles, you know, brings smiles to the faces of people who are, you know, who are perfectly healthy, and also people who aren't perfectly healthy. So in that way, it's sort of a universally, you know, accessible, you know, medium for anyone, you know, to enjoy. And
so before I ask you to do another song to a different group of breast cancer survivors, I'll ask you, how do you become that conduit to compose original lyrics and music?
I mean, for me, it was, I don't want to use the word drudgery, because that sounds like it's bad, because when it finally happens, it's so magical and ethereal. You're like, yeah, that's what I always thought would happen. But man, I mean, just, I've had lines that I have melodies and like songs. I still have songs that I wrote when I was like 19.
Yep.
And I haven't been able to fix them and make them work, you know, and they're sitting in a book. I mean, we just moved a little while ago, and I have these old song books with like lyrics in them, and I look at them and I go, yeah, there's something here, but like, it just keeps going the same way in my head. I'm like, no. That's when collaboration is a big deal, right?
You
give it to somebody and they go, oh, well, how about something like this? And you're like, oh, you just unstuck like decades of built up, you know, mildew in my head.
So what would come first in your mind, the lyrics or the music?
Music and melodies, you know, I just feel, unless there's just some perfect, you know, little statement that I'm like, ooh, I have to weld that to something, because it's just the perfect lyric. Usually for me, it's, I'll hear something and it'll make me go, oh, you know, that might be a cool, you know, intro for a song, or maybe a solo section or something, or a bridge, which are always really hard for me to write. I get into my verses and my choruses, and then when it comes time to do a bridge, I'm like, I don't want anything to change. It's perfect. But you have to. You have
to. Yes,
you
do.
Yeah.
Oh my God. That's where Lennon McCartney were so famous. Their bridges were phenomenal.
Their bridges were songs in and of themselves, like entire songs.
Yes.
I remember I sat down with a keyboard player once who was a bit of a loose cannon, but just a brilliant, you know, sit down there and I'm like, okay, I'm working on this thing. And he's like, oh, okay, like this. And I'm like, yeah. Okay, let's do that. And he's like, oh, maybe we could do here. We're like, oh, no, that's a whole other perfect song. Oh, or what about this? And I'm like, I couldn't stop him. It was like he cranked out like 9 things. And I'm like, we have an album here right now. And he was gone. Later that week. Musicians, William, musicians.
Oh my God. It's a different sphere that you occupy.
It sure is. And there's some tremendous highs and tremendous lows, but it's okay. Like, you know, the joys in the ride.
Absolutely. So now we'd ask you to pick up or to select a song or a portion of a song for a newly diagnosed breast cancer patient.
How about an original?
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's see if I remember it.
Yep.
When your only shot was taken and it vanished in the air, I will be there. I
situation's hopeless. When the fear you cannot bear, I will be there. I will be there. So your expectations shattered, and the battle broke your will. Whenever the pain is due, I will be there for you to lay your heart open wide. What you feel inside, heart open wide.
Thank you.
That is perfect. Great selection.
Thank
you. So that's an original.
Yeah, that's an original. It's called Heart Open Wide. And it's kind of, I've kind of adopted it as my theme song for the charity. You know, it's a message of hope and
yes.
spirituality and, you know, hanging in there.
Yeah.
That's really what it's all about.
Yeah, that's what we offer. We don't allow the F cancer stuff on the website and on our in our poetry and in our writings. Or we do survivor stories and in the webinars. This cancer is bad enough.
Yeah,
and so we're looking to just offer positive. As a matter of fact, this wonderful 80-year-old lady met up with us at Philadelphia Living Beyond Breast Cancer. And she said, what do you do? And I just looked at her without even batting an eyelash. I said, we inject positivity into the heinous fabric of a breast cancer diagnosis. She just looked at me. She said, you just made that up. I said, I did, but it sounds right.
We're going to use that.
Yeah. And then she came over and she said, actually, I just came over for a hug. I said, that's what we do.
Yeah.
We just do.
Yeah.
And back to our my little sojourn down the Lehigh River in Pennsylvania. At the end of the session, after the raft whitewater raft trip and the zip line and the beachhead, we closed with hugs. And this was pre-COVID. We closed with hugs. And this one gal, I still get very emotional about it. I'm sure she is long gone. I saved her for the last hug. And I gave her this hug. She would not let me go. She said, you have made my life.
Yeah.
And I just, we had to physically lift her up over the gunwale of the raft to get her in. She couldn't even get over. She was dying. And it just struck a chord to me. I said, you know, I'd like to do this, and I probably will do this the rest of my life.
Yeah. Yeah. You have those moments in the charities. If you sync up spiritually, soulfully with your charity.
Yes.
You guys obviously do. And I feel I do with Harmony and Healing, in that when you have those moments that you created that moment for her.
Mm-hmm.
And wow, that's all the support and reward you'd ever need, right? I mean, just that.
Yeah.
Moment.
Yeah. Big time. Laura, I'm going to turn it over to you. I've been hogging all the questions here.
Well, I'm so glad I asked you to help with this interview with all your music knowledge and everything. It was outstanding. I just think this is so phenomenal. And David, everything you say just like resonates. I know it's going to resonate with our listeners. I know they're going to be smiling on the other end. And we hear all the time too, just, you know, and I'm sure you might be aware of the power of music, right? And how there are these studies that you can look up on YouTube where, you know, people with Parkinson's disease who can't walk steadily, you put on some music or Frank Sinatra and they start dancing and waltzing like there's no problem.
Yep.
And then even hearing about, you know, the vibrations of music and how that could actually transform your cells at a cellular level to heal you.
Yeah.
So there's such great, amazing power in the work that you're doing. And so I really appreciate you bringing that to us and our audience. And so I want to leave also with, you know, how can people find you if someone's interested in learning more about your charity and the work that you're doing?
Well, I'm a web guy, so we have a website, It's called harmonyandhealing.org.
Okay.
And you can go there and visit. You can arrange virtual visits there, right from the front page there. Obviously, people can donate if they feel, you know, moved to. Again, our funding, you know, goes to support the musicians who deliver the services. And I don't know, it's a big love fest, really, yeah, over there. We're also on Facebook, obviously, and LinkedIn. And
great. I'll be sure to link to all of that information in your social media in the show notes below. 100%.
So could we end? I've got a special request, Cross the Universe by Lennon.
It looks like that one is getting vetoed and overwritten. David, what do you want to end with?
Hey, tomorrow's a far away. There's something I just have to say. I don't think I could hide what I'm feeling inside another day. Knowing I love you. Getting too close again. I don't wanna see it end. If I tell you tonight, would you turn up the lights and walk away? Knowing I love you. I'm gonna take you by surprise and make you.
This has just been outstanding. Go check out Harmony and Healing, harmonyandhealing.org. David, this has been outstanding. My jaw hurts from smiling for like the last hour and listening to your amazing voice and music and all of the good that you're doing for the community, for those who are going through any sort of illness. William and I both really appreciate you being on Breast Cancer Conversations, and I hope we can continue our collaborations and working together and promoting the great work that both of our organizations are doing. Thank you.
All right, my friend.
Thank you.
Thanks. Have for the a wonderful opportunity.
Thank you. This was very enjoyable.
Oh, good. I'm glad to hear.
Yeah.
Me too.
And thank you all for listening and tuning in week after week here on Breast Cancer Conversations. Please be mindful that all of our content and information is for educational purposes only and is never a substitute for medical advice. If you want to hang out, again, please check out survivingbreastcancer.org/events, where you can RSVP to our Thursday Night Thrivers weekly meetup, our Movement Monday classes, workshops, seminars, and so much more. We can also continue the dialogue online via social media. Our Instagram handle is survivingbreastcancer.org, all one word, and you can follow us on Twitter at SBC_ORG. Until next time, keep on thriving.